during the first row, over
No, I think I'm okay. Thanks.
to the Lord. His love is enduring. Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Praise the glory of his name. Say to God, how wondrous your works, how glorious your name.
Here.
Thank you.
Lettura della carta dell'Apostolo San Paolo allo Filippesi. Siempre que rezo por todos ustedes, lo hago con alegría. No puedo olvidar la cooperación que me han prestado en el servicio del Evangelio, desde el primer día hasta ahora. Estoy seguro de que Dios, que empezó a trabajar en ustedes, seguirá perfeccionándolos hasta el día de Cristo Jesús. Pues Dios sabe que los amo tiernamente en el corazón de Cristo Jesús. Y pido en mis oraciones que el amor crezca en ustedes y con él alcance el conocimiento y buen juicio en todo. Que sepan conocer lo bueno y lo malo en todo lo que se presente, y así lleguen puros y sin pecado al día de Cristo, llevado como fruto maduro esa santidad que produjeron gracias a Cristo Jesús, para gloria y alabanza de Dios. This is the word of the Lord.
As is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet.
herald's voice in the desert crying, make ready the way of the Lord. Clear him his straight path. His valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be leveled. The winding shall be made straight, and the rough ways smooth. And all mankind shall see the salvation of God. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Sister Mary Della Maria.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Maria Tecla.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Maria Nazarena.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Clara.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Shantinita.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Marisol. Sister Mary Viniakusi.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Premadura. Sister Mary Teres Joseph. Sister Mary Shapalika.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Maria Nisha.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Maria Goretti. Sister Emeraldina.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Esther.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Smriti Lata.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Vimala Augustine.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Drostilla.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Sarala Ann. Sister Mary Thessalina.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Divya Smriti.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Angel.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Alokesh.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Bernice.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Joseph Rina.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Grace Helena. Sister Mary Karunya Lata.
Lord, you have called me.
Sister Mary Frances Gabriel.
Lord, you have called me.
Evidence called the teaching, all of us present, Lord, when we walk into a home in the Church of Washington, you have our love, you always have our prayer. In your constitution, you read that a missionary of charity is sent on a mission to give a message to deliver to the world. As Jesus was sent by his Father, so now you are sent by him, filled with his Spirit, to be witnesses of the gospel of love and compassion in your community and among the poorest of the poor. You are to carry a gift to the poor. You are to manifest the healing touch of God that cures all diseases. You are to manifest the smile of God that warms all hearts. You are to speak God's own language of love that all hearts can understand. So the spirit of your life in your community is total surrender, loving trust, cheerfulness, as lived by Jesus in his holy life. Francois Mauriac says to us, we're all the result of our past. People come, people go, some live, some die. But each has touched our life profoundly. And I dare say that you, dear sisters, have been molded and shaped and touched by many throughout your life. First, loving parents, brothers, sisters, family, friends. They must have inspired you with their goodness and helped you to understand the mystery of God in our world, the mystery of God in us. But you were also touched by a wonderful event long before maybe any of you were born. I dare say all of you. It happened on a journey that a woman was making. On a train in India, and looking out the window, she saw mile after mile God's poorest of the poor. That woman felt in her heart, in her soul, the cry of God, go out and take care of my poor children. And there was born through Mother Teresa's, you might say, second conversion, your life. Your conversion to Father Jesus. Because you have chosen several years ago to end this religious life, to give yourself strongly to Jesus as a missionary of charity with a commitment to serve the poorest of God's poor. You are to live that life then. It means that you must have such an intimacy with Christ that you are motivated and moved not by social action, which is good in itself for many, but you're motivated by intense, deep, personal love for Jesus Christ. It helps you to live this total consecration of your life in the service of the poor. Your constitution reminds you that faith, it's God's gift. You did not choose this way of life, God chose you. He brought you to himself, he brought you into his mystical body of our church through baptism. He's nourished that faith throughout these years with Eucharist, prayer, reconciliation, with the innumerable works of charity. Your Holy Room reminds you that it's with an interior conviction, that you live and you dare to do things you would never have dreamed. Persuaded of your nothingness, with the blessing of obedience to your superiors in your community, that you attend all things for Christ, never doubting,
for with God all things are possible. As your mother reminds you, yesterday has gone, it won't come back. Tomorrow has not come. You have only today in which to love and serve him and let him be known to your life. And it is your aim of your rule of life to help our troubled world at the brink of its despair to discover a new reason to live and then to die with a smile of contentment on one's lips. How are you to do this? Face reality, look at this world. We are celebrating in the world today, not celebrating, commemorating. 50 years ago, our world plunged in a world that a more than intangible world caused millions and millions of broken hearts. Those wars have still continued. I have not spent 1 year of my priesthood, 34.5 years, there hasn't been so much in the world of battle raging. This is your world. We live in a world that boasts of tremendous conquest. We can put men in outer space. But we kill our unborn children as if it is nothing. Does it cause our conscience even a flickering? What a world is this you live in? We live in a world that still has the brand marks of racism. And injustice, you know it as well as I have done when I was a missionary in charity. And we live in a world that has taken what our forefathers and mothers handed to us as sacredness. And these things are now mocked openly. So yours is a heroic task. You are to go in a world that looks at Christ, doesn't reject it, just walks away as if so what. And you're supposed to come into this world and by the radiance of your faith as a missionary of charity, challenge that world. Challenge the world to turn back and think about God again. Take the realities of God's world and make it the bread of our world. This is a tremendous task. The church doesn't need more priests, more deacons, more religious, just as numbers. This has never been the need of the church. The cry of the world, the cry of the church, has always been, God, give us saints. Make us saints. 3 years ago, ordained a bishop in this very beautiful shrine of our Blessed Mother. I read the end of the Mass as part of my thanksgiving. Words of your own mother that said, be a saint. Be a saint for the church, be a saint for our world. And this is the challenge which I offer you today. You have been a missionary of charity for sufficient years, but you to be tested in the virtues of poverty, chastity, obedience, and the service of the poorest of the poor. Your religious superiors have deemed you worthy to come forth and take this sacred promise to God that until your death you will live this consecrated way of life as a missionary of charity. But if you are to live it, it takes more than just words. It takes God's presence in your life. And so today I simply ask you to make a commitment to Jesus Christ that you will live so intimately with Christ that every word of your lips, every action of your life will be His words, His deeds revealed in our midst. We want you to be saints. Above every altar in your convents are the words for the crucifix, I thirst. Christ still thirsts, not just the thirst of Calvary. He thirsts for justice. He thirsts for the goodness of human nature. He thirsts for peace on earth. He thirsts for those who are without homes and shelters and food and decent clothing. God looks into his world and sees the pity and the misery in human degradation, and he cries out, "I thirst for my children." You have said to God by your simple faith, "God, send me to take away the thirst of your people. Send me," and you did the prophet of old. My dear sisters, what are your vows? Poverty is your gospel life. The reason you live such a sinful life of poverty is not for the sake of having much, but that the poor in the world might see in you the gospel of Jesus Christ, who had not even a place to lay his head at night, and had to reach for another man's harvest for his food. As Chesterton reminds us, Christianity has not failed. We just haven't tried it yet on God's terms. And you are living your poverty by gospel standards, that you might be a saint, and that you might challenge us who see your gospel life to reevaluate the things of this world that so many times tie us down to the world, that do not lift us to God, that your life might challenge us to live gospel values. You promise obedience in a world that went insane when someone said, "Non servia," "I will not serve you, God." You come forth with the light of faith and kneeling before a human being as fragile as yourself. Say to that person, "I will obey you, because my faith tells me that in the church, God has assigned you to be his voice, his guidance for my life." It takes faith to live total obedience. The world, which sometimes laughs at all that is pure, listens to you as you consecrate yourself today totally to a life of chastity. It's liberating, as your rule tells you. It frees you to put your arms out to embrace the world in the love of Jesus Christ. It enables you to be unconditional in the giving of your entire being to God's holy word. You have pledged finally that you will see in men and women and children who are without any of the comforts of this world and its securities the face of Jesus Christ. Your mother reminded me so beautifully some years ago in India, and pointing out a poor man who was covered with the sores of pain and sorrow. This is Jesus. And this will be your aim in daily life, that when you see anyone, especially the poorest of the poor, you will see there the face of your Savior, and you will move towards them accordingly. If you are to live this heroic life of poverty by gospel standards, chastity, total surrender all to God, obedience to God speaking to you through lawful authority of the church, and the service of the poor of our lifetime, then there must be in you a presence that lifts you above the limitations of human nature. There must be someone in your life that it can empower you to be so transformed that you can feel, not on an emotional level, but feel on the faith level, the mystery of God in you, using you for his divine purpose. And this is what we celebrate today. We are not celebrating, my dear sisters, that you have just come here to pronounce your vow. We're celebrating that you have come here publicly before our bishop, our cardinal, before your mother, and all this rich community, to say to God, "I give you not only my hands and my eyes and my ears, I give you my heart and my soul. I give you my all." We're in a place sanctified, a place so holy, we call it the shrine of the Immaculate One, whose feast we just celebrated yesterday, Immaculate Mother of God, Mother of the Church. Mary had a faith so profound, so simple, that when God spoke to her and said, "I ask you, I'm not imposing. Will you become the mother of my son? Asking her to be the mother to save the world. When Mary knew about God was asking, she could for a moment have said, the task is too mighty. The world is too powerful for a poor, simple woman like me to bring to welcome with open arms. His birth, Mary's son, God's gift, Mary's gift to our world. I pray today that when you step forward to make your commitment of your life and the service of the poor so the poor today, in a consecrated way of life, open your arms, open your hearts to the Lord. Simply say like Mary, yes, God. Yes, yes, God. He's coming to meet you this Christmas. Run to meet him with open arms this afternoon.
Of breath. Saint Anne and Saint Joachim.
Pray for us.
Saint George.
Pray for us.
Saint Gabriel Possenti.
Pray for us.
Saint Joseph.
Pray for us.
Saint Peter and Saint Paul.
Jesus. Maria 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 and wholehearted and pure service to the forest of the world according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity. I, Sister Mary Teresa Savary, bow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Mary Teresa Savary, bow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Mary Divya Smriti Prabhu, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Mary, Grandmother Gomez, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Mary Angel Miranda, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Mary Vinayagin Ray, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitution of the missionary society.
I, Sister Mary Alexi, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Mary Madison Anthony, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Mary Bernice Cohen, bow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Mary Sarkita Lakara, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Mary Joseph Rita Joseph, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and
Sister Mary Clara Martin. Vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the contributions of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Mary Teresa Anthony, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity. I, Sister Mary Nazarena Bidoko, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitution of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Maria Tecla Cecchini, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity.
I, Sister Mary Frances Gabriel Saul, vow for life, chastity, poverty, obedience, and wholehearted and free service to the poorest of the poor, according to the constitutions of the missionaries of charity.
Thank you.
Father in heaven, we desire to serve you in your name and to sustain you in your care. For this and all your gifts, we give you thanks and praise. With love, no words can tell. You took our human nature and put it into yourself. You made it your bride, radiant in your own likeness, from the garden of the gifts of everlasting life. Even though your bride was deceived and deathless and profane, you did not abandon her. Love for your servant, thou wilt wish to renew the covenant. You first raised. You raised up a holy virgin from the spot of Jesse. The Holy Spirit was to come upon her, and your power overshadowed her, making her the immaculate mother of the world. He was poor, humble, and obedient, the source of all power, of all things. He made the church his bride, loving it with love so great that he gave himself up for it and sanctified it for it. In your loving grace, you have led countless daughters of yours to come to him as disciples and be honored as brides. Father, we earnestly pray you, send the fire of the Holy Spirit to warm it. As you sustain us in your mercy, receive our prayers and offerings. We ask this in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Joy in their end of grace. united us in eternal fellowship with your Son, who is Lord forever.
ask Our Lady to give us her heart, so beautiful, so pure, so immaculate. Her heart so full of love and humility, that we may be able to receive Jesus, the bread of life, love Him as she loved Him, and serve Him in the distressing disguise of the poorest of the poor. Let us thank God for His great love in giving us this beautiful gift of having our sisters consecrating their life for life to God, for the honor and glory of God and the good of people, poorest of the poor. We also let us thank the parents of our sisters who have been so generous in giving their children to God, for they are the most beautiful gift God has given to our congregation in having our sisters who are consecrating their life totally to Him in the service of the poorest of the poor. I'm grateful to His Eminence and all the priests who have been praying for us that this day be made all for Jesus through Mary. Jesus came to give us the good news that God loves us, that He wants us to love each other as He loves each one of us. To make it easy for us to love one another, He said, "Whatever you do to the least of my brethren, you do it to me. If you give a glass of water in my name, you give it to me. If you receive a little child in my name, you receive me." And when we die and go home to God, again God will say the same thing, "Come, you blessed of my Father, and possess the kingdom prepared for you. For I was hungry and you gave me to eat. I was naked and you clothed me. I was homeless and you took me in. I was sick and in prison and you visited me. Come, possess the kingdom prepared for you from all eternity." What a beautiful gift of God, that whatever we do for each other, it's done to Him. So let us appreciate the gift of God. And here now, we have our sisters here. Together, let us do something beautiful for God by bringing peace, joy, love to the poorest of the poor. Where does this love begin? In our own family. How does it begin? By praying together. Family that prays together stays together. And if you stay together, naturally you will love one another as God loves each one of you. That is why it is very important to bring prayer into our family, to get our families consecrated to the Sacred Heart, to bring rosary back into our families. What a wonderful gift of God it is to pray, because the fruit of prayer is the deepening of faith, and the fruit of faith is love, and the fruit of love is service, and the fruit of service is peace. So let us do those little acts of love for each other in our family first, and spread that joy and love wherever we go. Some time back, two Hindu young people came to our house and they gave me lots of money, and I asked them, "Where did you get so much money?" And they said, "2 days ago we got married, but before marriage we decided not to buy wedding clothes, not to have wedding feasts, and to give you the money." And I said to them, "How could you do that? Because our Hindu families don't do that. Why did you do it?" And they said, Mother, we loved each other so much that we wanted to share the joy of loving with the people you serve. Let us experience that joy of loving by giving until it hurts. So this is the joy of loving, that to be able to help each other to live in peace through love, through prayer, and through the joy of sharing. Pray for us also that we may continue God's work with great love. And we will also pray for you that you may grow in holiness through this love for one another. God bless you.